Hi, my name is Roger, and I'm here today to present PBH, and also give, well, I will give a little bit of an overview about PBH, which is a new virtualization mode in Zen. And I will also show some information about how to port an OS to it. This will be based on the work we've done with FreeBSD and the port of FreeBSD to PBH. First of all, I would like to explain the goals of this presentation. The main motivations were to understand PBH and architecture and to provide some hints about the implementation details. This will be done by presenting the new FreeBSD PBH port. As a starting point, I would like to explain a little bit the Zen architecture. Probably, if you have used Zen before, you know its architecture. But basically, Zen runs on top of the hardware. It's a microkernel, and it runs directly on top of the hardware, and it has access to basically the CPU and the MMIU. That's all it takes from the hardware, and the rest is assigned to what we call the control domain, or DOM0. That can be either NetBSD or Linux. This is done in order to reuse drivers already present in operating systems, so Zen doesn't need any device drivers. It doesn't need drivers for block or net or anything like that. It's all done by the control domain. Then we have this control domain, and we have, I put two examples. One is a fully virtualized domain, that which we usually call HVM, and the other one is a paravirtualized domain, which we call PV. Paravirtualized domain can be either Linux or NetBSD or FreeBSD 32 bits, and then fully virtualized domain can be any kind of guest. You can use Windows, you can use OpenBSD, you can use almost any kind of operating system. So we'll start by describing the main issues on PV. One of the issues with PV is that it requires a PV MMIU. When PV was designed, there were no hardware virtualization extensions, so in order to have different guests running on the same hardware, you actually need to paravirtualize the memory management unit. This is a very intrusive piece of code in the guest OS, because you need to actually modify the core of the guest in order to add support for the PV MMIU. NetBSD, for example, chooses to do this by having a completely separate memory management code, and you actually have to compile a different kernel to run under Zen that you have to do to run on bare metal. On Linux, they choose to do something different called PVOps, which is that they basically use to choose different MMIU implementations, but this code is really intrusive, and both the Linux maintainers are getting a little bit pissed about this because it's hard to maintain. And also, it's really easy to introduce bugs in Zen when you modify code that should not be related to Zen. But if you touch code around PV MMIU stuff, there's a chance that you may actually mess up without even noticing. And the other problem with PV guest is that the performance of 64-bit guest syscalls is slow. This is mainly due to the fact that on 32 bits we have three protection levels. We can isolate the guest user space from the guest kernel using page tables, and then we can isolate the guest kernel from Zen using something that's called memory segmentation that was present on 32-bit hardware, but that when doing the transition to 64-bit, AMD decided to drop because it was mainly not used by anyone except Zen. So at that point, when running on 64-bit hardware, Zen had to play a little trick in order to run 64-bit guest. That's the kernel and the guest is isolated using page tables, and then the guest kernel and the guest user space run on the same protection level, and Zen takes care of the context switch between user space and guest kernel. This is actually quite slow because each time you have to do a syscall, you have to call Zen in order to change from user space to guest kernel space, and it's not really optimal. Then we also have HVM guest, but it also has its own issues. Mainly, each HVM guest requires a QEMU instance in the DOM0 or in a stub domain that takes up memory. It's also using what we call the legacy boot, which is that we boot and then we call the emulated BIOS and then we jump into the kernel. This is slower than PV. And then we also have a bunch of devices emulated inside of Zen in order to provide better speed. We have the timers emulated inside of Zen, the HPED. We have the APIC also emulated inside of Zen, so it's actually a little bit slower. So what's PVH basically? Is a PV guest run inside of an HVM container. And we aim it to use the best features of both PV and HVM guest. You don't need any emulation. It's either emulated by hardware or it's done using paravirtualization. The guest also has a native MMIU, which is good because we can get rid of the PV MMIU operations, and has access to the same protection level as a normal guest. The code was co-written by Mukesh Rathod at Oracle and George Dunlap at Citrix. And now we have a table that describes the different kind of guests that you can run on Zen. On the top, we can see HVM guests, which is using hardware virtualization for privilege instruction and page tables, and then it's using software virtualization for everything else. This is quite slow because it means that the access to the I/O devices is done using emulation. QEMU handles that emulation, but it's slow. So we have an improvement over HVM, which is HVM with PV drivers, which is basically HVM, but it has paravirtualized drivers for the network card and the disk. And then we also have PVHVM, which is one step further of the previous one, and it's using hardware virtualization for the page tables and for the privilege instructions. But it's using paravirtualization for the disk and the network and the timers and the interrupts. There's still a little problem with that mode, is that it requires the legacy boot. You have to boot it through an emulated BIOS, and basically it requires QEMU. On the other side, we have a pure PV guest. We can see that it's using PV for everything. But we have the problem with 64-bit PV guests that are actually slower to perform privilege instruction and page table manipulations. And in the middle, we have PVH that should be using hardware virtualization for the CPU and the privilege instructions and the page tables. But it's using PV for everything else. That means that we have the PV booth path, which is much faster than HVM, and that means that we also don't require QEMU or any emulation behind it. So, as we said before, PV runs inside of an HVM container, so it doesn't make use of the PV MMIU. It also runs at the normal privilege levels. This means we don't need to do any kind of hypercalls in order to perform privilege instructions. And for PVH, we also disabled any kind of emulation that was done in HVM. We disable all the emulation that was done inside of Zen. And we don't launch any QEMU or anything like that in order to do emulation. And it has the nice thing that PVH uses the PV start sequence, which means that we jump into the guest kernel with some basic paging setup. And it uses the PV path for several other operations that were not used on HVM, like we use the PV path for vCPU bring up, we use the PV hypercalls, and we get the memory map also using PV hypercalls. And we also got something from HVM, which is the PVHVM callback mechanism. We'll see a little bit more about this in further slides. But it's basically the way Zen has to inject events into the guest. That's done using the same mechanism that's used on PVHVM. Then we have some difference with PV. As we saw on the slide, the page tables are in full control by guest. Page tables are no longer controlled by Zen. The guest is free to modify page tables as it wishes. We also use what we call the GPFN inside of the page tables. That means that the page tables contains the address that the guest sees, which doesn't have to match to the hardware address underlining it. It doesn't have to match the physical address on the hardware. The translation is done by Zen because it runs inside of an HVM container. Also, the interrupt description table is controlled by the guest. It can add as many interrupts as it wants. There's no PFN-MFN difference. In Zen PV, we used to have a difference between what we call a PFN and an MFN. PFN was the address that the guest sees inside of the kernel, which matched an MFN, which is an actual real physical address on the hardware. And in the case of PBH, the guest is only aware of GPFNs. The translation is done by Xen. We also have a native syscall sysenter, and we have the native IO privilege level, and we don't have any kind of event or fail self callbacks. As the difference with HBM, if you want to boot a kernel with PBH, you need to add what we call ELF nodes. These are nodes that are appended to the kernel and that Xen reads before booting the kernel. It mainly tells Xen which version of the operating system you're trying to boot, the name of the operating system, the entry point into the kernel, which features the kernel expects from Xen in order to boot. It's some nodes that you append to the kernel, basically. It boots with paging enabled. And there are some differences in the way the grand table and Xen store is set up, but they are very minimal. It's maybe 5 lines of code that you have to add to your grand table or Xen store implementations, basically. It also doesn't have any emulated devices, so that means that you don't have the emulated APIC or the emulated timer, so you have to use the PB timers since the beginning of the kernel. You cannot use any kind of emulated devices. We also have quite a lot of things that are not yet working on PBH. It's something very new that was introduced in this release. Well, it's going to be new in the release that's going to come out in maybe 1 month. And we are still missing a lot of things. We are mainly missing support for AMD hardware. Right now, PBH requires that your hardware is Intel and that it has EPT. This is something that we will try to work around for the next version. It's also limited to 64-bit guest, which means that you cannot use 32-bit guest. You cannot make use of the virtual TSC. As I said before, you actually need to have EPT in hardware because we don't make use of the shadow mode in Xen. We also don't have support for vCPU hot plug, and there's also no support for migration yet. We expect to work around this soon in the next release, probably at least most of them, in order to have proper PBH support. So now I would like to speak a little bit about the status of FreeBSD before importing PBH support. FreeBSD had full PBH VM support. It has a working Xen store and grand table implementation. It has event channel support. It has the disk and network frontends and backends, what we usually call block front and block back and net front and net back. They were fully functional. We also had the PBH VM vector callback in order to inject events to specific vCPUs. We also had the PB timer. We also had PB APAs, and we also had the PB suspend and resume sequence. As I said in the previous slide, this shows the difference between what we call the PBH VM vector callback and the previous mechanism used to inject interrupts into Xen, into the guest, sorry. In the previous implementation, we can see that interrupts are injected using a PCI interrupt. This means that the interrupt is injected by Xen, it's delivered to the Xen PCI driver, then this driver calls the event channel code that ends up calling either the Xen PB or the Xen PB disk or the Xen PB NIC. If we introduce the vector callback, the event is delivered directly to the event channel of call, and it can be injected to any vCPU. And then you can deliver that interrupt to PB disk, to PB NICs, and you can also deliver it to, you can also use it to deliver PB APIs and the PB timer. So the implementation of the PB timer in FreeBSD contains several components. We have an event timer, which is in charge of delivering events to the operating system. This is done using a single shot timer implemented by an hypercall. Then we also have a time counter that's in charge of keeping track of time. That's done by reading the information in a shared memory region that's provided by Xen. That's called vCPU time info. You can search for that in the sources and you will find quite a lot of information about this struct and what it contains. It basically contains some values that allow you to calculate the current time. And then we also provide a clock using the information found in that structure. So we can get all of our time requirements from the PV interface. We don't need to use any kind of emulated device. It's actually quite simple. Then we also have the PV APIs. On bare metal, APIs are delivered using the local APIC, but as we said before, on PVH, we don't have the local APIC, so we have to deliver interrupts using event channels instead. This was also done for PVHVM because it turns out to be actually faster to use event channels than the emulated local APIC in order to deliver APIs. And once you deliver the event to the guest has this wired into the API handlers, so we can get rid of all the emulation overhead that we had when we were using the local APIC, the emulated local APIC. We also had the PV suspend and resume protocol. This is actually not that difficult to get. It mainly requires you that when you resume, you have to rebind all of your API event channels, and you also have to rebind all of the BIRQ event channels that are used for the timers. You have to reinitialize the timers on each CPU. You have to actually reinitialize the timer from the vCPU itself. You cannot do it from other vCPUs. And finally, you have to reconnect the frontends, disk and network. This was also done before PVHVM, so we didn't actually need to touch any code inside of the disk or the network drivers in order to obtain this. So what was missing in FreeBSD in order to get PVH support? We were missing the PV entry point into the kernel. Since we were using PVHVM, the kernel was booting using the normal boot sequence. So we need to add the PV entry point into the kernel, and we need to wire that entry point into the FreeBSD boot sequence. We also need to fetch the memory map using hypercalls instead of the data provided by the BIOS. We also need to add, to port the PV console from the old PV port into PVH. We have to make it common code so it can be used on 64-bit also. We also have to get rid of the usage of any emulated devices. In fact, PVHVM on FreeBSD when booting was using the emulated timers before the PV timers were able to set up. Now we have got rid of that, and PVH is using the PV timers all along the way since it boots. And we also need to add support for bring up of secondary vCPUs. This is done using hypercalls, and it's in fact much more simple than what you usually have to do in order to bring up secondary processors. It's really simple and it's not intrusive code in general. And finally, we had to cope with the fact that we didn't have ACPI in order to get the hardware description. So all the hardware description in PVH comes from ZenStore instead of ACPI or any other kind of hardware description mechanism. So these slides contain the resulting architecture of the PVH port. We have the Zen Nexus, which is the root level device in FreeBSD. We actually have a specific Nexus for Zen. And then we have the Zen PV bus that's connected directly to the Nexus. And the Zen PV bus takes care of attaching the devices needed in order to work under Zen. In this case, for PVH, the Zen PV bus attaches a dummy PV CPU. It also attaches ZenStore that in turn initializes grand table, and then it attaches the PV timer and the PV console in order to get output from the boot process. Then from ZenStore, as we said, it's the place where we get the hardware description actually. We get the disk and the NIC. We could have a lot more of them. I've only added two on this slide, but we can have as many disks and NICs as we want. And then we also have the control interface that's a very small driver that's basically in charge of reading power events from ZenStore, like a shutdown, suspend, resume, this kind of stuff. It read from ZenStore, and it's then wired into the FreeBSD power control mechanism. And then we also have handling from the Nexus, what we call the event channels. The event channels are the things that we use to deliver events into the guest. and it's directly wired into the Nexus, although the PV disk and the PV NIC use it directly by calling a specific PV event channel functions. Then I decided to run some benchmarks on this new implementation in order to find out the performance. We expected the performance to be at least as fast as PVHVM, because we are mostly using the same mechanism that used inside of PVHVM. And well, there are still a lot of things that need more work in order to perform better, but I think that in general it's a description of where we are now. Don't expect it to be something set in stone. We expect to improve that results, but at least it's a starting point. The benchmark, we're running a low-level hardware. Well, it's a Xeon, but it's not actually server. It has 8 ways. It contains 5 gigabytes of RAM. The storage is on LVM in order to obtain better performance, and then we limit the number of vCPUs to DOM0 to only one, and the memory that the DOM0 can see is set to 1 gigabyte. For the test, we were using Zen 4.4 release candidate 1, and for the DOM0 kernel, we were using Linux 3.12 release candidate 7. Then on the guest side, we run Linux PVH, and Linux PV, Linux PVHVM, and Linux PVH. And then we also run FreeBSD PVHVM and FreeBSD PVH in order to have a performance comparison between both. All the guests were using the same template. Each one had 4 gigabytes of RAM, 7 vCPUs, 1 paravirtualized disk, and 1 paravirtualized network interface. The same VM was used for all the tests. The only thing that changed is the way in which the VM was booted. Sometimes it was booted as PV, PVH, or PVHVM, depending on the test that we wanted to run. And the code used for the guest kernel can be found on the following JIT repositories. The first one is the repository from Conrad that contains the latest PVH Linux port. And the second one is using my FreeBSD JIT repository that also contains the latest PVH implementation for FreeBSD. You can also find all this information on the Zen Wiki, so you don't actually have to copy these addresses if you want to test it afterwards. There are, in fact, wiki pages about how to test Linux PVH and Linux and FreeBSD PVH on the Zen Wiki. So I started with a fork benchmark. The fork benchmark, what it basically does, it has a loop that spins fork and then waits for the child thread to die. And here we count the loops per second. That means the number of times this loop was executed. In this case, the higher the result, the better the throughput, because we mean that using a specified time slice, we were able to fork more times. We can see that Linux PV is really slow on those tests. This is because the PV MMIU is quite as slow at doing page table manipulations. And on the other side, we can see that both Linux PVH and Linux PVH VM are mostly equal. We expect them to be exactly equal, or maybe PVH to be a little bit faster. So it shows us that we still have some performance issues on the PVH implementation. This is expected because the implementation is really new on Zen, so there are a lot of things to improve. And on FreeBSD, we can actually see that FreeBSD PVH is a little bit faster than FreeBSD PVH VM, but they are more or less equally. Then I wanted to run a Linux specific benchmark that's called Kernbench. What it does is basically it compiles the kernel and outputs the amount of time it took to compile the kernel. This was done using 7 jobs. I don't know if you can see on the top the title of the graph, but it was done using 7 parallel jobs. We can see that the faster one is Linux PVHVM, then we have Linux PVH, and finally we have Linux PV. We know that Linux PV is slower because we saw on the previous fork test that it was slower doing forks. So since Kerbench does a lot of forks and spawns a lot of threads, it's expected that PV is actually slower on this test. And then we can see there's a difference between Linux PVH and Linux PVHVM. We saw that difference on the previous test also, on the fork test. We saw that Linux PVHVM was faster, so it was expected that it will also be faster on the Kerbench benchmark. Then I also ran what would be the Kerbench equivalent on FreeBSD, which is basically building the FreeBSD kernel. And we can see that the performance is more or less equal, but FreeBSD PVH is a little bit slower than PVHVM and has higher deviation in this test. More or less, the lower FreeBSD PVH value is more or less the same as the FreeBSD PVHVM performance. Then I also run SpecJBB, which is a Java benchmark. And I was able to run this test on all the different kind of guests, but I would not like to make comparisons between Linux and FreeBSD on this test because they were actually using different Java virtual machines. So it may be due to that, that one is actually faster than the other. I don't know, but it's kind of hard to compare them if you use different JVMs. And actually, the FreeBSD JVM was compiled using CLang, and the Linux one was compiled using GCC, so it's really hard to make comparisons here. But we can see that Linux PV is faster on this graph. This is due to the low TLB locality of SpecJBB, which favors PV. Then we can see that Linux PVHVM and Linux PVH are more or less equal in terms of performance. And finally, we can see something that I'm not sure how to explain. I think it may be due to the fact that on PVH we don't export the correct flags in the CPU ID. For example, the Zen implementation I was using here was not reporting SuperPage support to FreeBSD. This is due to the fact that, as I said before, PVH is still in the works, and it's something that we just need to properly report. It's there, it's supported, but it was not being notified to the guest. Then I also run another test, which is an FFmpeg encoding using 12 threads. In this case, the performance is more or less similar across all guests, but we can see that FreeBSD PVH is actually slower. I don't know if that may be due to the use, to the fact that we didn't export SuperPages to PVH. I'm not sure because I think FFmpeg shouldn't be using SuperPages probably, but it's hard to say. So finally, I would like to talk a little bit about the future work that we have on both Zen and FreeBSD. Mainly, we have now full FreeBSD PVH guest support. I'm also working on DOM 0 support, and in fact, there are some patches on the mailing list in order to boot FreeBSD PVH as DOM 0. Don't get so excited because it's only able to boot. We don't have any devices needed in order to interact with Zen, so you cannot create guests, you cannot do anything, but you can boot as a DOM 0, and FreeBSD is able to recognize the hardware behind it, which is real hardware. It's no longer the PV devices because DOM 0 has access to the real hardware. And finally, we also need to port the tool stack. We need to port LibXC, we need to port LibXL, we need to make sure that QEMU is working fine under FreeBSD. And that will be more or less what's needed to get FreeBSD DOM 0. And on the Zen side, as I said before, we are missing quite a lot of support. We are missing support for AMD CPUs, for 32-bit guests, for migration, for PC pass-through. There's a lot of work to be done, but it's being done by more than, I mean, it's not only me that's doing that. There are quite a lot of other companies working behind PVH. So we expect to have it fully working sometime in the near future. Then for the conclusions, we can see that PVH should provide performance similar to PVHVM, while being more lightweight. We no longer need to run QEMU in the DOM 0. That's great because we are not sucking up memory from the DOM 0. It's also much more easier to implement because it doesn't require a PV MMIU. It doesn't require as much modifications as a pure PV port does. And it's also nice because it shares a lot of similar things with PBHBM. This provides a nice transition pass. You can start with a pure HBM guest, then you can add PBHBM support, and finally you can add PBH support. If you are going the PB way, you only have a guest that you need to port to PB. There's no intermediate steps in that process. And finally, we can also make use of hardware-assisted virtualization, which is faster than what we were doing in PB. So as I said before starting, the goals of the presentation were to introduce PB, to provide an overview, and finally to provide some details about the FreeBSD implementation. And I hope that this presentation has motivated people in order to collaborate with either the Linux PBH port, the FreeBSD PBH port, or Xen in general. Now, if you have any questions. Do we have a mic or? Well, I can repeat the question in the meantime if you want.
How long do you think it'll be before you expect PBH performance to be where you expect to be, so where it's beating PBHBM?
The question is when we expect PBH to be to beat PBHBM or to at least be as performance as PBHBM. I'm not really sure because we have identified some issues. The one that I said about not exporting the correct CPU ID flags is an important one, in fact, because it prevents us from making use of super pages. So the wise answer will be to say that I will have to rerun those tests with the right CPU ID flags and see what's going on there, and then trying to track down what's missing or what's causing the performance penalty on PBH. Yeah?
When you fix this issue about the performance?
Sorry?
When you fix this issue about the performance, will you suggest to enterprises to move from HBM to PBH? If so, it will be easy to migrate?
From HBM, well, the question is when we expect companies to move from HBM to PBH? That depends on what operating system the company is actually using. If it's using Linux or FreeBSD, it will also be quite straightforward to move from HBM or PB to PBH. If they are using another operating system that doesn't have PBH support, it means you have to port it to PBH. So that depends on the amount of people you have, the amount of work you want to do. I mean, it's hard to say. And also it depends on the adoption of PBH by cloud providers. If, for example, Amazon starts offering a PBH solution, I expect it's going to become much more used, but it's not under our hands. Well, thank you.